Alright. So, I'm Oliver Seldman, and this is Kevin.
Yeah.
Alan. Kevin Collin.
And, as Cristofano mentioned, we saw that somebody had requested a talk on hooks, so we figured we'd go for it. So, can I, like, see a show of hands? Who thinks they understand hooks? Okay, and who's, like, successfully used a hook before? Okay, so actually more people have used a hook than understand it.
This explains a lot of contributors.
Very interesting. I really did not expect that. I really didn't. There's a little joke up here, implementation of hook presentation. It's like a little coding standard. When you're referring to a hook, you kind of, in your code, you kind of refer to what implementation of the hook it is. We're going to get to some of that later, though. So just wanted to throw a little joke in there. Why hooks? So Drupal uses a hook system to allow modules to basically to customize what's happening. There are a couple of other content management systems, other applications that use hook systems, but Drupal is it's somewhat unique in that it uses it so extensively, and so that's what we all have in store for ourselves. But what does this mean? What does a hook mean? Basically, it's running through a bunch of different actions, and as it happens, it's basically going through the modules and looking for if any of them incorporate or employ a hook for the process that it's running. So all of this stuff is happening behind the scenes, and as it's happening, you can kind of throw your little bit of custom code into one of these processes and affect what happens with Drupal. There are a number of different parts of each of these processes and a number of different stages that you can hook into these various other modules, both in core and contrib. And so basically, the hooks are a way to add to or to alter the way that Drupal works without actually having to do too much. Like, basically, the developers have really kind of set it up so with the understanding that you are going to be coming in and affecting what's going on. And so it actually is quite powerful. You can break a lot of things if you're not careful. But I don't want to scare you because it's really easy. It's really easy. In many of your favorite modules also provide hooks. So today we're just going to be talking about core hooks, which are the hooks that are provided by Drupal core. But Vue has hooks, and I mean, as I said, just about any of the big modules provide their own hooks so you can affect how they're working.
Rules like is hooks. implement rules with hooks.
So that was the intro to what a hook is. I saw a hand. Do you?
Yeah, that's like saying, that's like defining hook by using the word hook. So I was wondering if you could back it up to a higher level. I mean, I will understand it when you get into the code of it eventually, but just so I can take off from the right spot, hooks, as I understand it, is where a modular application has defined vocabulary to use.
Are you coming from the coding standpoint?
No.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, I was trying so I guess the question is to try and define it again.
Define hooks without using the word hook?
There's an actual vocabulary. So every single thing that can happen, every single thing that can happen has a hook, right?
like an event handler.
Something's initiated.
Yeah.
It's like an event handler.
And that's why it's so frustrating.
Don't get into programming patterns.
Along the way, facts are.
Did you want to add?
Yeah, there was a great analogy coming out of DrupalCon. And the presenter basically said, like, Drupal Core is saying to you, the module, hey, I'm going to the kitchen. And it tells the module, hey, I'm going to the kitchen. So, and the hook responds to Core saying, hey, give me a sandwich while you're there.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Well, actually, so you, to use that same analogy, so you know, Drupal saying I'm going to the kitchen, and what the hook is basically is it's saying does anyone else need something when I'm going to the kitchen?
Yeah.
And if you do, tell me now because I'm on my way to the kitchen, and you can kind of come in and tell me how to affect my what I'm doing. During that little process.
It does wait for everyone's request though before it finishes going to the kitchen.
Yeah.
So don't worry.
Thanks.
And you can kind of get in like when I get up to go to the kitchen, when I'm about to get into the kitchen, when I'm coming back from the kitchen. So there are a couple of
designed for flexibility.
The modules are in line though, and you can change their position in line. So just keep that in mind. You can get one to get its request in before another one, and sometimes that affects things.
Or can screw you up if you can't figure
you
out why you're there.
Is it possible to have a module without hooks?
You can have one without hooks, but you probably don't want to. You probably just want a menu item, and you need a hook for that.
Yeah.
You need to use a hook to get a menu item. So
you do need.
You can have one, but maybe only a joke module would actually do that.
The badge on that one.
So actually, I mean, I not to like cut everyone off, but I do get into some more details about this as for the next few slides, and so that hopefully that will help illuminate things a little more. So what are hooks? They're just a function. That's all it is. There's nothing complicated about it. The concept we've tried to explain a couple times, but it's really just a function. And one of the big complicating factors for somebody who's just coming into it is, so you don't actually use the word hook at all. Hook just refers to the module or you're referring to the second part of the hook, the in this case user, is which hook you're referring to. And the first part, the hook, is just always replaced by the module that is calling.
So this would be the hook module calling hook user.
Right, and this is actually taken, this is not, I mean, I have here an implementation, this is actually an error. I have an implementation of a hook error, of a hook user, but the function I just took off of the API page, so it's actually not an implementation of hook user, it's just hook user. If it was an implementation of hook user, it'd be my module _user.
Can I add?
Sure.
Can you go back real quick? Yeah. So I was just going to add that a function, for those that don't know what a function is, in Drupal, a function is the smallest piece of actionable code in Drupal. So what that means is that, so if you're creating like simple tests or stuff like that, then with simple tests, you can test every single function in your custom module or in a particular module. So just to explain what a function is in case people were afraid to ask.
So there are a couple of other pieces. The reason I put this little bit of code up here is just because there are a couple of other little pieces that I wanted to point out here. So this just for anybody who's curious, this is for Drupal 6. One of the ways you can tell that is that there's an op here. And the op stands for an operation. And in Drupal 6, many of these hooks I also get into this a little bit later. There are actually many like mini hooks inside of the hooks. So when you call hook user, they're, you know, in fact, actually let's pull up the page for that. I think there's a the Node API one. Yeah. Okay. So here, if you look at the hook, this is hook Node API, which is also just for 6. I'll explain to you the difference in a moment. But you'll see here's a list of all of the different ops that you can switch on. So what you're really saying is, I want to hook into this whole kind of nebulous node process. But what do I want to do? I want to affect something on update. I want to affect something on submit. I want to affect something on insert.
This is what you said about any time between announcing that you're going to the kitchen,
exactly,
and getting back here, you can hook in at any point.
Well, I mean, different hooks define different operations, and so
insert's like, I'm going to the fridge, I'm going to put something in the fridge. What do you want? You want me to put anything else in?
Actual function. Yeah.
And update,
yeah,
is like, I'm changing what's in the fridge.
Can I just, for redundancy's sake, what they mean by action up there is like a function. You know, so it's, once again, the smallest piece of actionable code, just for redundancy.
So, in this case, you can see there. I mean, the reason I chose Node API is because actually there's quite a bit that's going on, as you can see, quite a bit that's going on inside of Node API. I'm actually just going to keep skipping ahead in the slides because I talk about the differences between 6 and 7 in a future slide. I mean, they're only like
two
more
slides.
Here's
the slides.
Just wanted to point out that, so I actually grabbed this from api.drupal.org, which is something that you should, every developer should look at all the time. I constantly use it. But you could see, like, if you're like, okay, what are the parameters that hook user takes? So you can just see, it tells you which ones it can take. And then this is a little example off the page. And this is kind of how you work with the operations in Drupal 6. You do a switch on the operation, and then you give a case for each of those operations that you want to do something for. And so here, where this dot 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 is, that's where I'd be doing something on a user insert. I'd be, you know, doing some other, affecting something during a user insert. That's how I would do it here. So I just wanted to mention a few things that kind of gotchas, and people use terminology that sometimes sometimes hard to understand. There are just a couple of things. We talk about exposing a hook. So like a module will expose a hook, and that means that it creates its own that you can take advantage of. We talk about hooks firing, and that's kind of what we were talking about using the kitchen analogy, or using this idea that Drupal's kind of doing all of these actions behind the scenes during each of these, loading a page or loading a user or any of these actions. When we talk about which hooks are like happening during that process, you'd say that this particular hook fired. And then invoking a hook is kind of like exposing a hook. One of the big things you can do is make your own hooks. If you're writing a module, you can create your own hooks. I'm not going to get into that because we're just trying to stay at an overview stage here. But I mentioned in the previous slide, we were talking about the switching on the op, In Drupal 6, we switch on the op, as I mentioned, it's kind of like hooks inside hooks. So there's one hook, but then there are many different things that it does. And in Drupal 7, remember I just showed you hook node API? So in Drupal 7, each of these ops is actually its own hook now, which makes things a lot more straightforward. One of the major differences between 6 and 7 is this change.
Yeah, and API just got tired of doing all these things with the fridge at once, so it's like, just give me one thing at a time.
Yeah, just tell me when you're coming to the fridge to insert something, and I'll deal with that as its own little piece. So you can see that, you probably notice a lot of the same hooks that we were referring to in operations on the previous one are their own hooks here: hook node insert, hook node load. So I don't know if you want to just click on one of those, like hook node insert. You can see that the parameters that it takes in this example here is just the node. So before there was a whole series of multiple parameters that you have to pass it in order to get it to do what you wanted. In this case, it simplifies the hook naming system, but it also simplifies the parameters that it takes. So if you're kind of jumping, I mean, I don't know how many people have need this talk and would also be upgrading a module from 6 to 7. But if you are, you know, you should be looking at api.drupal.org and checking out the differences between the way the hooks are called.
And don't forget that Coder Upgrade can get you started. And I presented on that last month.
Please refer to previous video presentation. And okay, so there's one more kind of coding-based gotcha that I just wanted to try and explain. It's not really related to hooks, but it's important conceptually. And I'm also going to show you a little trick here. So the item is passed by reference, and actually, so here's an implementation of hook form alter, which allows you to as you can imagine, alter a form. And here you'll see that the form has an ampersand before the actual form variable, and you can actually see that the form alter one does, but the form ID doesn't. And the difference, that ampersand means pass by reference. And actually, when I first got into coding, that was something that was kind of hard for me to understand. And in fact, Marco, a friend of mine, Marco, explained it to me way back when. But so this concept is that, so Drupal is using this variable form for lots of things. And in fact, when we call hook form alter, we're calling it for any form, every form. In this case, the variable form is something that Drupal is using for a bunch of things. And in this case, when we say pass by reference, we're actually affecting the original. So in normally in these cases, once this function gets the form ID variable, it's just kind of internal to the function. If it's not passed by reference, it's something that we can affect within the function, and it doesn't affect the original variable. In this case, though, we're actually talking about affecting the original. So I don't know if people have some more questions about what that means, but basically, if you see the ampersand in front of the variable, you know that it's being passed by reference, and whenever you affect it, you're affecting the reference, not just a little internal version of that for your function.
However, in Drupal 7, it's a little different when you're passing objects into a function. Objects are passed by reference automatically in PHP 5, which Drupal 7 requires. So that's why this hook doesn't have an ampersand before node. But if you change node in here, it'll change node. Arrays are still the same. So if you're dealing with an array, like in hook form alter, you should still put the ampersand.
But again, referring to api.drupal.org, I can't say it enough. If you have a question about it or what version of the variable or array that your function is grabbing, your hook is grabbing, referring to the reference is a great resource. So in this particular little example here, I'm using a function called DPM, which is something that's provided by the devel module. You can also use the Drupal core function called Drupal set message. And all it does is put a little message up at the top of the page. But so for this is a little trick that I actually learned from a Lullabot video. So if you want to start playing with hook form alter, you want to know what form you're going to be working on, you just create a module. All you do is do this, put DPM form ID, and basically anytime a form loads, it'll put a little message up at the top of the page with what the form ID is called. And so you want to say, okay, I want to affect the node edit form. You go to the node edit form, and up at the top it'll tell you it's, node edit form. And in this case, actually form IDs are words, it's not a number. It'll tell you like the word of that this is the node edit form or something like that. I actually don't know if that's what the node edit form is called.
Anyway. Now it's called type node form.
There you go.
With underscores and stuff.
And so
we have an example.
That's actually it. I just wanted to go to the last slide.
No, we gotta show the example before we wrap up.
Oh, reference, yeah, okay, sure, fair enough. So all you have is some examples from Kevin.
Yes.
Let's see the code.
This is the code. So this is really simple code. It was supposed to be simple code. Well, it just implements hook node API, which we actually talked about, and just one of the operations, which is a really common one called view. So this is when it's going to show the node. So let me first show you like what it's doing. It's really, really simple. And if I was a real presenter, I'd already have it open. And then Chrome wouldn't have to ask me, do you want to go there? But anyway, now I'm a real presenter. But anyway, so this is basically just telling you if you own the node or not. And it just checks the owner of it, and then it prints a message like, this is owned or not by someone else. So, like, to prove this, I'm just going to edit this one. What? Oh, after logging in. Little bit of troubleshooting.
You were just testing us.
Just testing, yeah. Edit, and then make it owned by, like, one of my random new users. Save it.
Green has a question.
Green has a question.
The projector is vibrating, so if you could please increase the font size significantly, I think that'll help with visibility.
Okay, let's try this.
You.
Okay. So, oh wait, well, it's still owned by someone else. It would have said it was owned by me in the beginning. So anyway, then I'll change it back. And like magic will happen and so on. As they say.
Unicorns will sprout.
See, I'm the owner.
Mike also suggests jiggling the cable.
Jiggling the cable? That actually had no effect.
It did a little bit.
Yeah, there you go.
Am I going?
Yeah,
hey, Oliver, hold the cable.
Yeah, okay.
I'll be the cable holder. Can everyone still see? Okay, so let's see how this happens real quick. So, like, this uses the Drupal set message that Oliver was just talking about. Blah, blah, blah. You know, if the owner is me, then I, like, just set the message. You know, I'm setting the message beforehand to one or the other. And then I set the message here with whatever I put into it. So you can see that it prints out in that green box by default. That'll be dependent on your theme, how it actually looks. There's a few, you can check this in the API also. There's a few like things you can give it, like success and error and warning and stuff, and you'll get different boxes, but that's not too important. But then anyway, the main meat of the function is here, where I change this thing called node content. So like content is a sort of what's called form API, which is how you make forms. It's like a form API-esque type syntax. So if you learn this one, you will also be able to do forms pretty much, and vice versa. You might want to learn the other one first. But in any case, you see, so I'm just putting it around divs, and then I'm saying this like page, story, web form, whatever. Oh wait, NID is what? Hey, what? Whatever. Ignore that. That's at the bottom. I already showed the message, but then I put another function in there that I forgot about. So
the presentation was longer. But
if we look at the bottom, you can also see that this web forms NID is 2. This is actually coming from the module because I edited that node content thing. So the main thing here is the value. And so that's what you would want to put into it if you want to add something. And you also got to give it a little name. You can call this pretty much whatever you want, as long as it's not something that exists. If it's something that exists, it'll change it. So, like, I don't know, if I wanted to change the body or something, then I could figure out what the body is called. And using that DPM thing that he talked about is good for figuring out what stuff is called. Because, like, the body is weird, for example. So if you put like body, it probably won't work. It's like body, feel, body, this and that, content. Yeah, so people are agreeing that the body's weird. So anyway, you will probably want to check that out to actually know what you need to change. And then you can do it. And you know that, you notice, because it's by reference, you just change it, you know, the ampersand, and then it just happens. So like you're changing the actual node object there that Drupal gave you. Essentially, it's like, hey, this is what node looks like now. You want me to do anything to it? And you're like, yeah. And it's like, okay,
And then when it outputs it, when it outputs it like normal, yeah, then it works. Well, I mean, you can see you can do other things too, like set messages, which has nothing to do with the node. But when that action's happening, you can get it to do things as well. So probably the best point, it's probably best to go into questions now, so you can ask me, like, why did you do X? Oh, that's right, the reference and then questions.
Yeah, yeah.
So let's do the, where to look for stuff.
Yeah, so there are a couple of resources here. The first one is the two hook pages on api.drupal.org. You can go to just /hooks and it'll go automatically to 7 because that's the current one. But I just put 6 and 7 here, so you can use that as a reference. There's an awesome kind of visualization that Cristofano pointed out to me from Angie from Webchick at Lullabot about, it's called Drupal Exposed, and it actually walks through how to make a little couple of tweaks to core, to how to hack core for in a test site, but just to show all of the hooks that are fired during some of these key processes. And it's really interesting. So if you call it at the right place, you can literally see all the hooks that are being fired as Drupal does its stuff. And you can it also talks about how to do that with theme functions and theme template files as well on the same story. And then just wanted to give a quick shout out to Chris Shattuck at buildamodule.com. A couple days ago, he had all of the modules, all of the videos were free. They're back to pay now, but this particular one, the introduction to hooks, is still free. There are a bunch of free ones, and this is one of the free ones. So it's like a 10-minute video. He goes briefly, touches on some of the stuff I talked about, and then actually goes into more examples and stuff. So yeah, I guess now, if you have any questions, now
like,
wait, let me
it's like 10 or 15-20% of the actual build a module videos are actually available for free. So even though they're not all free, there's a lot of them that are really useful.
Let me give one resource too. Like, you can get the code for this example on Drupal.org. It's in a sandbox, which they have now. So if you look me up and you look at my stuff, that's the wrong one. If you look me up and go to my user page and you scroll down the projects, you see use hooks. You have to use Git to get it, but you can basically get the code that we showed here if you want to take a look. Questions?
Is it possible that someone here could ask Chris Shattuck for a subscription to buildamodule.com and then raffle it off?
It's possible, and in fact, he might actually send that to us. And yes, no. So I happen to see that he had relaunched his site, and we kind of talked with Cristofano,
yeah.
And we sent him a little message.
A subscription to raffle off tonight.
And he sent us a couple videos and a couple of month-long subscriptions to the site. Yeah, if you scroll down, he's got it's like more than a day's worth of videos here on module. All of this is Drupal 7 module development.
Actually, he said that you could watch all of them in like just under 24 hours. Uh-huh. Sleep.
I think you cut out the commercials.
Yeah, yeah.
No, there are no commercials. This is Chris Shattuck, who has written a ton of modules. We'll go into that later when we raffle it off. But thank you to Chris Shattuck for giving that to us to raffle off.
Can I get a ticket now? Because I didn't get one.
yeah, I know you want a ticket now. Yeah, now that you hear what the prize is.
It's a value of $29 per month.
That's right. So can you guys
post
the links that you have in the slides to the comments on
sure.
tonight's event?
And in fact, I can just post the slides. They're just it's just a Google Doc, so I can save it, and
yes.
We can post the slides there. I mean, if you have any questions, you can also just ask either of us.
Are there any other people in the audience?
Now you too can bump the DTLA meetup to the top of GDO.
Yes, Jeffrey.
So another non-programming question. That's nice to see the code there, and I know that it's going to function real good in Drupal when you put it in the right place, but am I looking at something as if I'm looking at a TPL file or a CSS file?
Yeah, no.
This is a module file.
This is a simple module file.
So
module file?
What is it?
And you can see, remember?
It's a
It's a .module file.
This is actually the .module file.
This is the no frills version of this. I was gonna have a GUI and stuff, but it's the module file.
Yeah, and so you can see. Remember, on his.
So you're saying that in core there's a .module. That's where it is, and then in your theme folder you would have a something that so it functions with.
Oh, I know how to show it.
No, so what you would do is you look up
one of
them. Can
you repeat the question?
Okay, yeah. So the question was basically where do you put this and how do you use it? And so you would actually create your own module file, and so what you need is a .info file. So in this case, he created. Remember his module was called use hooks. So you see. The way we implemented the hook node API is that it's use hooks node API. So that's the name of his module, the use hooks module. So there'd be a use hooks.info file and a use hooks.module, and then this would be inside of that module, and that's it. That's all that's inside the module. And now you would get what to put here from api.drupal.org. So you don't actually have to go into any of the core modules to see where they expose the hooks. You'd look at the reference and find which hook you want to use.
And just like with your contributed themes, you put that in sites all themes. Contributed modules go in sites all modules, including contributed modules as well as custom modules.
You could also create a custom folder in your sites all modules folder to put all your little custom ones there.
All right, we have time for one more question.
Yeah, another question? You had one over here?
Because that string OP is a Drupal 6 module, is that correct?
Uh-huh.
Am I reading that?
Yes,
okay.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Right.
And the question was?
The question was, because is this module a Drupal 6 or a Drupal 7 module? And he was just noting, because we're switching on the op, it's a Drupal 6 module.
And then to make it Drupal 7, I mean, would it be as simple? Well, I guess.
In Drupal 7, because this is Vue, it would be use hooks underscore node underscore view.
Okay.
If you go to the node API reference, you'd see all of the possible versions of the node hooks. And the page that we loaded with all of those possible new hooks in 7 was just, I just did a search on hook underscore node and then nothing else, and it pulled up all of the node hooks. Node hooks.
All right, thank you, guys. We will be having a Drupal After Dark tonight, and you can ask Oliver and Kevin over beers all the questions.
Only Oliver.
We don't have time for right now.
Actually,
thank you again.
Not me either.
Well, I have one question.
There's a Drupal 7 hook.
How
we
many people
keep
are comfortable with the pass-by reference versus pass-by dolly? And
it's a breakout room.
Yeah.
So, I just wanted to add that this awesome presentation was like, today my word is crowdsourced for some reason, I don't know why, it was crowdsourced. So someone on, I think it was San Diego Drupal Group, asked for, hey, does anyone know of a cool hooks presentation? And these two gentlemen stepped up. So what that means is that if there's anything that you guys and gals would like to see, please post it on, groups.drupal.org/LA. And if people like the idea, they might like come up with a presentation.
Yeah,
we also